Oracle, I have a brief announcement, and we apologize if I didn't say, but the students did an outstanding job for dinner tonight. This is something that called away on emergency, and she apologizes, her questions will be read, and she would like a transcript of the tape sent to her, or she'll pick it up, so she can watch it. Thank you. Roll call, please. Yes.
So sorry. Okay, so I'm gonna get this back here. Mrs. DeBay?
Here.
Mr. Huber?
Here.
Mrs. Fleischer?
Here.
Dr. Swenson?
Here.
Mrs. Ross is here, and Mrs. Serco. Six, come on.
Okay, can I have a motion to approve the agenda tonight?
So moved.
Right. All of the papers say aye?
Aye.
Do you have any room for papers?
No.
Do you have a...
They're actually on the tables.
Okay. There are three like five card back one. If you want to write a question to be asked of the candidate, we'll do that after you've asked all our questions. And if you have them, you just put them in the air and maybe they'll pick them up.
Ms. Harris.
Pardon?
Ann Harris.
Ann Harris is here, too. She's just on the...
Well, I didn't see you. Mrs. Harris will pick them up.
Important to understand
people and their jobs, what they're doing on a daily basis. Most critically, first, I think these two overall goals will kind of go overarch over the entire presentation, but I think building relationships with the school board is priority number one. It is priority number one for me, for what I think is critical to us working together to accomplish things that the district needs to accomplish, whether they be challenges or celebrations or unforeseen things. It's going to be, you never know what will happen or what you need to address, but establishing good protocols and relationships with the board is critical. I think as well, the community, members of the community, elected officials in the community, we serve our district, as everyone knows, serves so many different townships, serves so many different communities. There are a lot of different elected officials, we have different police forces. So reconnecting with those people and reflecting on how we can support each other in the shared interests of our organizations. And business leaders as well. We really have a lot of business and industry in this area. I know at Panko, we did a lot of outreach to those communities, developed partnerships with them, but at the district level, I think that there's some real possibility there as well. And then I put last, that reaffirming and strengthening relationships with staff. Obviously, I've been here for 19 and a half years now, and I've worked at different levels throughout the system in the district, but I think it's more about reaffirming and strengthening relationships with staff and reconnecting with a broader group of people. The second large goal is to work to really look at programs, things that we offer students, things that we do in our support services, things that we do in business, in human resources, in curriculum, how we look at things in the district, how we view student success, how we look at staff morale, climate, culture, all of those things count as programs. And really look into how we can start providing support for people and what they do, for students and what they do. And then critically, I think it's important to make data-based decisions on the information that is derived. So again, this is a we task. It's not necessarily a me task. This is a collaborative effort, but making some data-based decisions with always the focus on student proficiency and achievement. So first, to dive in a little bit on the first goal, very important to build trust and understanding between the school board and the superintendent. I obviously had a chance to work with some of you for some time now. Obviously, the relationship between superintendent and school board is a special relationship. It is a different relationship than that with other individuals in the district. And I think some of the things we just did this evening, for example, are great activities for a school board and superintendent to have to get to know people on a level. It just, when you know someone more, the more you know them, the more trust there is, the more information flows, the more authentic communications become. I think that it's very important for goal setting that we have collaborative goal setting, shared goal setting, that there's an establishment of approved communication protocols, and I'm very flexible to that. I'm very flexible to the needs of the school board and how they would like to see communication, what works for each individual school board member or as a group and a whole. It's important to gain input from all board members in this endeavor, that all board members have a stake and interest in goals and communication that is acceptable and something that works for them. I think it's a good idea, we've done this quite a bit, but it's a good idea too to reevaluate meeting procedures that we have. We've had several different meeting structures over the past couple of years, tried different things, and it's a good idea to reevaluate, to reinvigorate that conversation as well. And then it's always important to share results with the full board. So even if you're speaking with an individual board member or having a conversation with one or two board members, it's important that input that comes to me, shared amongst a small group of us, is shared back to the full board. We really need to accomplish things, I think, with more shared information and allowing input to flow more freely and in a less restricted manner. Again, much more detail, and it goes into other issues in the packet. The second is take a look at our organizational effectiveness and efficiency. I think always looking at an administrative structure is always a good thing to take a look at. There's a lot of different ways that people run schools and school systems, a lot of different positions, a lot of different responsibilities. It's a good idea to take a fresh look at that. Building operations and the way those things are done, managed at the building level or at the central office level. And it's going to be time in the first 100 days to take a good look at the 2017-18 budget based on the timeline of this position. So it will be time for potentially a first amendment of the 17-18 budget based on the timing of the position. Again, a theme that I'll bring back, it's important to gather feedback from district employees with this. When taking a look at effectiveness of positions and structures and systems, feedback from people who are working in those systems right now, that are working in those structures, so you learn from their experiences what's working and what's not working. It definitely individual meetings with administrators and visits with staff and buildings. I think we need a little more goal setting. I think we need to do some goal setting that is more specific than we've done in the past. We have endeavored to take on some district-wide goal setting through strategic planning. I think that's important. I think we need to do more measurable goal setting, have timelines within goals for when we hope to meet them or when we will report back on the results of them. But even within buildings, I think it's very difficult. Staff can be frustrated when they don't know if things are going well. How do we know if we're moving in the right direction? How do we know if this program or this thing we're trying with students or this intervention we tried is working? And these can be very specific based on the need of the building, the need of the department, and it's important to work on those collaboratively to measure them later and see if there's success or what needs to be done to adjust. Certainly follow and monitor contractual commitments within all contracts, depending on where we are in the negotiations process. It would be either hopefully following all settled contracts, but if not, continuing negotiations on unsettled contracts and ensuring that they're posted properly, that they're in final form and they're listed in the proper transparent way on our website. And then I think it's important to pour into the budget, just to take a fresh look at expenditures and revenues by source and classification of those expenditures and revenues. Obviously, raising expectations for all students. This is not a cliche. This is a critical mission of the district. This is the central mission of the district. It is important to have a high expectations culture in our school district. And that is not something that's felt by individuals. That is not something that is felt by individual grades or schools. It is a district-wide culture that needs to be established, reestablished, that we believe that all students need, deserve, and have high expectations. Again, goal setting and adjusting the strategic plan when necessary to look at this issue. Timelines on curriculum. We have been working, but need to continue the commitment to establish a timeline of when our district curriculum will be articulated in a way that's accessible, viewable, and in a standard format. We began this, but continuing on that and giving regular updates to the board as to when you'd expect to be able to access curriculum in a way that can go through a protocol for how it's viewed and understood. Gathering input from staff and community on our district assessment structure. We have a lot of different assessments in the district. We had some conversation earlier today about the difference in elementary assessments versus middle school versus high school. We obviously have state mandated assessments, but we do a lot of other assessments in the district that we choose to do as well. I think it's good to look back at those and reassess why we're doing all these assessments. Do they align, articulate vertically between the elementary, middle school, and high school? And if there's ways to streamline those and make it more effective for staff, more helpful. Again, reaffirm and keep it on the front of conversations with individuals that we're gonna make decisions based on data, that we're gonna look at data to make decisions, not when asked if this is a good idea, does the data suggest that it's something that would be a good intervention? Does the data suggest this is something that would be helpful moving forward? Get really people in rich data conversations as part of the way we talk about teaching and learning. Talked about going into programs, specific programs of race, student achievement. We got a lot of great things going on in our buildings. We have wonderful things going on. And some of them are hidden gems. Some of them are occurring in one or two buildings, but not being used across the whole district. It's time to spotlight those programs and see where they can apply in other places across the district as well. I've got some data in there, the points of pride. We've had a very good run lately of AP classes in the district and named the district AP honor roll two times in the last several years for two things, both increasing the number of AP classes and for students, how they performed on the AP test. We've really seen a dramatic increase in not only kids participating in AP, but then when they're in the program, taking multiple AP classes. And I think it is very important to have an AP for all mentality in the district and encourage participation of lots of students into AP programs. And what you see is the more participation, the more success students feel. It just raises the standard of education at the high school level. And then any kind of programs that we use right now for remediation or recovery, support programs, special education programs, see how those can be viewed differently or streamlined to benefit students. Talked about data and focusing on that. We've dabbled in this a little bit, but formalizing data meetings and buildings and with administrators, taking a deep dive into recent data results that they have. At this time, it will likely be, based on the timing of all of this, it will probably be the spring 2017 testing that will be, well, we hope will be out in the first 100 days of this position, and it'll be a very good time to look at that in depth. We are getting seeing a few more reports on that, so we get a little more student-level data. It becomes very useful for making decisions at the building level. And I think it's also a good idea to establish a data protocol. In other words, a system by which administrators and teachers can look at data that's similar across the whole district. So developing, training, and discussing with staff a protocol for looking at data so it's saying something similar across the district. So when a piece of data is viewed by someone at Tenniswood, it feels the same way as when it's being viewed at Green, for example. So it's a good basic understanding and a protocol of review data. And then academically, growth and proficiency goals for students and for schools based on those results. This goal is very, very, I think at the first interview I really focused a lot on this particular goal. I was talking around this goal, I believe. I think relationships are the blood of our district. They are the backbone of our district. Family atmosphere is, again, a cliche. And if you haven't been in Lance Cruz, then you think it's a cliche. If you've been in Lance Cruz, you know it's not. You don't mean something meaningful. It means something that you're supported in your role here. You're supported when you come to work. You feel very important. You feel like you're validated, and you feel like you're making a difference for kids. And that needs to be reinvigorated in the district. It's a critical piece. Climate and culture is the first mission, I believe, of this position. Because it's right there and it can come right back again. This comes from feedback, support of individuals in the district. I think that there are some social media uses here that could be powerful to share information more easily, to make some of these great things going on in our schools more easily visible to a broader community. Again, open door policy means a lot to many people. This doesn't just mean that we will have meetings, that we will have, you can be invited to things that are formal and structured. This also means the superintendent going out to people, going out into their work environment, into their comfort zone, to draw out from them what they feel like are their challenges and strengths in their position. So it's open door in the sense that people can come to me, but I also feel very comfortable and desire to go to them. That's through building visits, department visits, etc. It's very important to create contact with community leaders. We just had an election in November. We had a lot of supervisors change. We had a lot of people at our local level change. It's important to develop a network with them, to meet with officials in Harrison Township and Clinton Township in Chesterfield, work with the police force, work with the sheriff's office. We have a good relationship with some of those people, but reinvest those contacts. They're very invaluable for working together to solve problems and to garner their opinions and to get ideas from them as to what to do, get ideas from them as to how to take on challenges. They see a very different side of the community and their input is very important. And then working with booster clubs and parent groups, I think we can create meetings here. We can create meetings, parents advisory and other types of meetings here, and those are important. But let's get into the meetings that exist already in the buildings. Let's get into those meetings where parents are there for a reason, for a very specific reason, for a passion that they have about their kids. And lastly, certainly but not least, advocate for Lance Cruz Public Schools. It is absolutely a critical mission of the superintendent of schools to advocate for Lance Cruz above all else, and to fiercely defend what we're doing here at Lance Cruz at the MISD, the state, and the federal level. It is, I believe, the job of the superintendent to shield employees from some negativity, from some pressure, from some mandates that are on them, and to really advocate and push back when appropriate to work on issues such as funding, such as local control. Those are really important things, and I think you need to have a relationship network to be credible in that realm. You need to have relationships and be able to establish relationships with people to be effective. They're very important. So again, a lot more detail in the program here. I suppose I'll go at the end of my presentation, I'll take a seat. And I, you know, just the goal is to work together. Let's work together to make Lance Cruz an even better place to grow and achieve. So thank you very much. Any questions?
Spencer will read Mrs. Hilton's questions for us. All right, Don, you want to start?
Thank you.
Setting educational standards is incredibly important in this role. How do you ensure that these standards are set clearly, communicated, and met?
Well, it is important. Sorry, there we go. It is important that they are done collaboratively with people that will have to carry them out, with people that are responsible, directly responsible for the teaching and learning of students. So it's important that they're done in a setting and in a way that's effective for that particular building or that particular department or that particular group of students. So I think goal setting is a very general word. I think it needs to be done at the district level, certainly, but I think district goals come from the needs of the district. They come from the needs of the individual schools or individual issues within the schools in order to see what the general trends are in the district. I don't believe it's the right approach to set goals from the district and then assume that everyone else will follow and come to those. I think we need to go to the groups of people, and then I think that they will be followed because they're meaningful for the needs of those individuals and those individual buildings.
Can you tell me about a time when there was an established policy or procedure that you veered away from to obtain a better solution?
Well, there is not a time that I can recall that I have veered away from a policy. I assume we're talking about board policy, but maybe even more informally and just a general policy. I think if I did, there is a time I can think of. There is normally a policy that you would call parents if there's something going on with a student that's personal in nature and they disclosed it to you. There's obviously appropriate protocols to tell parents about what's going on with the student. When you suspect that a child is being abused by the parents that they may live with, then you don't follow that. You don't follow that policy. You wouldn't follow the protocol. So I think to protect kids, you have to protect children, then that would be one of the only exceptions to not following a policy.
Good evening. During our first interview, you were asked many questions on curriculum.
Yes.
Example, board involvement, level of performance, innovation, and assessment. I would now like to ask you to go into more detail on how you will examine, in a step-by-step approach, the district's K through 12 curriculum, who would be involved, what steps you would take, and expectations that you may have.
Well, that's a very large endeavor that involves many, many people. But I think it is correct that you have to have a structure in place so that the process for doing that is transparent and obvious to everyone. So I think first, it is reestablishing, reviewing the policy that would exist for curriculum redevelopment, analysis, or new curriculum to be developed. I think there's sort of three phases of that. That is analyzing the state of a current curriculum, being in the understanding that it needs to be revamped or redone, or perhaps creating an all-new curriculum. So I think there's sort of three buckets there, at least, that you would have, want to establish procedures on how they're followed. I think how that would be done would be that you start with the group of people, again, most affected and most interested by this. Teams of teachers, administrators, stakeholders are very important groups to work on such things. There's a variety of time so you can do this. If it has to be done during the school day, that can be important to do. There's other opportunities to do it at other times, but it's getting a group of people educated about the need, about the goal, so they become a sort of the driving force of the change or of the redevelopment. So again, you have some credibility at different levels administratively and teaching. Perhaps a parent would be involved. Perhaps you'd have other support staff involved because they're about carrying out the change in the curriculum. They research, they do the study, they make recommendations. Then it is rolling it out to the larger group, rolling it out to the administrative team, larger group of teachers, bringing it to DCC, presenting it to DCC, presenting it to the school board. I think at all steps of this, the school board is informed as to the progress of it, but they always obviously would receive a formal presentation at the end of everything that occurred. But I, the steps that are followed can be consistent. It's but the way it will go, the manner in which it will take place, the twists and turns that occur based on what you discover or what the needs of are in our district could be different. But again, the overall steps would be similar. Well, it's first of all, it's about what the goal or what the issue is. I think generally speaking, they should be used very sparingly because I think we do have a lot of talent within the district for addressing our issues and for analyzing problems within the district. Frequently, we don't tap on the shoulders of our own talented individuals, of the strengths and interests of our own employees to address some of the issues that we have. I think the only time you look for a consultant is if there's a consensus that you need to address this issue from a totally outside perspective. If the goal is to learn about an issue from a totally foreign or different experience than we've had in Lance Cruz or even Macomb County or even the Tri-County area, so then it might be appropriate to do that. But it would have to be based on the fact that the goal of the project or the outcome is something where you're trying to draw in from a resource that we don't have in the district. But again, I think that's pretty rare and would be used sparingly.
And the second part of that question is, have you utilized consultants or advisors in your office?
I have not. No, I have not hired any consultants, although the ISD would be our next step of resource, and we utilize ISD, obviously at no expense to the district, but we use ISD consultants very frequently to help us with professional development, curriculum planning, whatnot.
And that last part, just to reiterate, is you indicated that the appropriate time to bring in one would be if you lack the expertise in the district.
Right, but exactly. I think some searching to see if it exists and some drawing on people's, again, strengths and interests would be a first step, and I would be surprised if that would be needed very often.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
One of my goals there for the Lance Cruz School District is to support the development of a world-class educational system for the communities that we serve. Describe your vision of a world-class education system. What does it look like? As superintendent, what role or roles must you play and what actions must you take to turn that vision into a reality?
I think, first of all, it's important to research and understand what we want the definition to be world-class in the district. So I think it's defining world-class first. And just, you know, just putting out a definition of that or creating a mission statement that has that in it does not necessarily mean you have the foundation or understanding of what world-class means. So what I would suggest for that myself would be that it is certainly an eye on the future for our students. It's an eye on the future reality of our students, of what careers, possibilities, jobs, what their lives will look like in the future. That can be difficult to do, but that's why I think it's important to teach students skills that are transferable, teach in a way that is authentic, teach in a way that transfers information of students into real life situations, testing students in a way that's meaningful and authentic. I know I've talked to lots of parents in our district who started in jobs that are nothing like the jobs they have now, and they feel very uncomfortable. They've got some foreign travel involved, going to places where they're not speaking English, asked to engage with different cultures. So I think working on a cultural competency, discovering cultural competencies within our district, I think that's very important for our students. I think it's important for them to see things from other perspectives and understand that sometimes something said is taken a different way. And I know we have adults in our district who are being put in that position all the time and aren't comfortable with it. So how do we prepare our kids for jobs that don't involve a border, that don't occur within a few miles of Lance Cruz? And what will those things be? But it's, again, skills are important, but transferability of those skills to other possibilities is very important. That will make students worldly. That will make them applicable, those things applicable in the world. And world class means that you've looked at those things and you're creating and designing programs that prepare the kids for that future. That you put a view, a gaze on your programs to see if they're preparing them for sort of this, the world is flat future, for, you know, positions and jobs that may exist that we don't even know about right now.
So you started your question and you talked about how you create a shared vision.
Yes.
Can you talk a little bit about what your personal vision is? And so, then once that's determined, then what role, because you would be playing a different role, what role would you play as superintendent to turn that vision into reality?
So I think personally, again, it is having a program, having programs that are recognized, having programs that actually connect kids with their futures, having evidence that kids are prepared for their futures. There's a fair amount of post-secondary surveying done and connecting those results with the programs we have in the district. I think, again, preparing kids for realities, not just attainment of information, of facts, that's a very important part of that. I think the role of the superintendent in that is, again, applying that lens when reviewing programs, when designing curricula, when asking those critical questions, four or five critical questions of programs to see if they pass the test of, is this world class? Is this something that is worldly? Is this something that's transferable? So the role would be to keep the conversation going with administrators, with teachers, with community members, with parents, and keep the communication consistent so that we look at things through that lens when we're analyzing them.
Okay, thank you. Mm-hmm. Lowry dollars are supposed to be part of School Aid Fund Michigan. The legal notice said Lowry money is taken out of School Aid Fund and put into the general fund, making this funding just a pass-through. This has contributed to the funding problems for traditional K-12 education in our state. Aside from your administrative groups, how would you, as superintendent of Lance Cruz Public Schools, individually engage our state legislature and governor to address this gross assault on school funding?
Well, this is a very important role, and it's an increasingly important role. To be an advocate, an effective advocate, I think are very important roles of the superintendent. I think just saying things, broadcasting emails, making statements is one thing. But I think it's forming, again, back to forming relationships with those key players in those positions and finding ways to develop relationships with them, because I'm well aware that when people hear information or advocacy from someone they trust or know, whether they agree with them or not all the time, it's taken more seriously. It's taken more to heart. It's taken under consideration more. So I think it's very important to get to know legislators, to get to know local representatives, but even more broadly, find out who the players are in certain bills in packages, in legislation that's moving forward, and form relationships with them. Again, you don't have to agree with personal beliefs of someone or the bill that they've released, but if you have to find some ground and understanding, because I think the goal is that students are more successful, that learning occurs, that students are doing better than they were in the past. I think that's everyone's goal. The approach is quite different between different groups of people. Start with what you agree with, form, deepen relationships, and then when you need to call, visit, discuss an issue that's a critical issue or of, you know, there's a vote about to occur of utmost importance, you're being listened to over others. You're being listened to over others because you have some credibility with that individual to begin with.
Okay. Please describe the pros and cons of using sinking funds versus general bonds. General bond funds to accomplish district goals based on what you have learned about our district. Which would you suggest that we consider for the future and why?
There are pros and cons of both. Sinking funds are pay-as-you-go funds, but they likely raise the millage rate on taxpayers, so there would be a noticeable impact based on the size of it, of course, into taxpayers within the district, even homestead taxpayers. If you're creative and can do some refinancing, we've done some refinancing in the past with our bonds, you can perform that mechanism while you go for a traditional bond, and you may not have to raise the current 7 mils we're levying. So I think we levy 7 mils right now, and traditional bonds allow you, although you are borrowing, it allows you to, if you work, I know if you can do things creatively and get a good refinance, you can work to not raise taxes or raise them more minimally than in a sinking fund. Again, but back to a sinking fund, it is more of a pay as you go. So you're not reaching out the debt into the future and not extending that, perhaps the refinance you're paying as you go, but it does raise them more immediately. I think we have been successful paying back bonds in this district. We've gone for traditional bonds more frequently. Those have been worked, and I would, at this point, quick answer is that I would advocate for that. But again, if the situation occurred that a sinking fund made more sense, that's a very productive board superintendent conversation. That'd be a good decision to make together. But at this point, probably a traditional bond.
Thank you.
What is the primary difference between school board and school district goals?
Well, I think there is, certainly there's a mesh of them. They do mesh together because the school board goals are governance goals of the district. They're goals of governance of policies and procedures of the district. District goals are established from the direction of the district, from the policies of the school board. So again, goals are, the framework of goals are created by school board goals, created by school board policies. And then district goals are made within that framework. So I think that they can blend together. I think the goals can be the same at times. I mean, there could be school board goals and district goals that are exactly the same. Some district goals could flow from school board goals. So the school board goal could indicate a district goal that is needed or important. Thirdly, the structure of the school board goals gives parameters for which the district goals can be created. So I think there's more than one possibility there. Create goals, school board and district.
How would you actively pursue avenues of additional income for our district?
Yes, certainly adding income to the district is a more positive approach than reducing the budget, if it's possible. So that's certainly something that needs to be actively sought out, actively searched. I think we've done a lot of that in our district. We've been pretty active at trying to seek out income sources, trying to create programs that sustain. We do a lot of that at where we just had dinner at the Panko Center, where programs receive funding. We receive students from other districts. So it's looking at, I think, right now how we draw income sources in, how we enhance our revenue stream from, and seeing if we can enhance those, add to those. But I think really it's the biggest way to do that is to advocate for our school district, to advocate for our school district in Lansing, to advocate for our school district locally, advocate nationally as well, because the answer for more money to the district comes through policy, comes through legislation. That will make the greater impact, is if we can turn the tide and really show evidence of the quality of Lanzcruz Public Schools and why they're deserving, we are deserving of additional income.
Budgets can sometimes be confusing and controversial to staff and the public. How will you work towards creating a balanced and manageable budget by not being penny wise and pound foolish? And would you consider utilizing outside sources to help make these important decisions?
That's a great question. I think penny wise and pound foolish can be a mechanism. I touched on that the last interview, that it's very, very important not to get caught in that, in the trap of making lots of little cuts, especially ones that aren't agreed upon or understood, thinking that that will be more, that'll be easier to accept, that it'll be easy for the district to understand or accept. And quite frankly, the emotional response of some of those very minor cuts with a very minimal budget impact can be worse than more significant reductions or cuts that need to be made. So again, that's a very important lens to put things through, and you have to test these things. You have to talk about them in a way that's open and honest, and see, I think, the receptiveness to programs, to reductions in one place are very different than they are in another. So it is finding out where the penny wise and pound foolish line lies, and not doing something that seems minimal but really has a worse impact than something more significant. I think budgets are confusing. I think the more detailed they get, the more accurate they are, but the more confusing they get. So you have a reverse, sort of the paradigm reverses on that. I think it's important for people to trust the budget, to believe the budget, to have it be transparent in a way that it can be explained. And I am up myself. I want the budget to be detailed, to have everything in there that's correct, auditable, everything lines up. But I also want a version of it that's more simplified, that's more easily understood, that talks about money in a way that's more general and understood, because I think that you need to be able to present it in a way for someone who has an accounting background in a very detailed manner, because that's the level of detail they're going to demand and understand. But someone who just wants a general understanding of it, that can be overwhelming to them, and they will be more, perhaps more confused or more distrusting of it when presented that way. So it's important to show it in different ways, show that they agree and that they align, but have a simplistic version and the version that the business office would use for their purposes, so that it's there's an everyday version of it as well.
This is Mary's question. As an educational institution with the sole purpose of brain and intellect development, it is important to hire the most qualified person. Has there ever been a time when you chose to hire someone that did not meet the educational qualifications of the job description? If so, why?
I think you always are looking for a best fit in a position. And when you attempt to restructure, or when you repost a position, let's say someone has left a job, or you're looking at the position differently, or even the same way as you did before, the fit for that position at that time could be different than it was in the past, or maybe in the future. I think that to be qualified for a position is a very broad set of criteria. There's formal qualifications, there's informal qualifications, there's work-based qualifications, there's educational qualifications. So no, I don't think I've been a part of doing that as far as someone that wasn't qualified. Everyone wants the best qualified candidate. No one benefits if we hire someone who's not the best qualified for a position. So I think agreeing upon qualifications is the important step that needs to be done first. So then that doesn't become an issue. So agreeing on what the qualifications are broadly can help address that issue.
If the fit for the position changes over time, is it the practice to modify the job description prior to the posting?
I would prescribe to the practice of modifying the job description prior to the posting, if the fit was different and the intent was different in the position, yes.
This is my question.
Okay.
I am sure that in your preparation for this interview, Eric, that you reviewed our assessment and financial data. Please identify one or two areas of concern that you noted, and then describe action that you have taken in the past in your current position to address the same or similar concerns, as well as the outcome of your efforts.
Sure. Assessment data can be overwhelming, and it can be viewed in lots of different ways. But I think most recently, I've given this similar speech from a very similar position recently to this board about scores at one of our buildings in the area of math. And we have some very similar performance in other areas and had a disparate performance in math where it was lower at one of our schools. And it was a great opportunity to validate the needs and concerns of the individuals in that department. And they were looking for assistance with this. They wanted to support students better. They wanted to do better. These people were working very hard every day. This was not an issue of teachers or a group of people not working to the best of their abilities. They needed new tools to support students in the way that they were learning. So what we did was looked at, with very collaboratively with the department and the principal, looked at an online support system that's nationally known. They came in and actually took our test data, our PSAT data from our 9th and 10th graders, and pre-built a question bank. And these are all application style questions. These are all SAT preparation style questions to what the needs of the students were based on our previous test administration. Then beyond that, it's adapted to the students so that the students are getting adaptive questions, more difficult or more easy based on what their needs are. And then the teachers are getting feedback from that as to how they need to individualize with the students. So I think that's been fairly recent. We've only just started that a few weeks ago, but it has had good results. My communication with that department and with the principal on this issue has been regular. It has been very positive, and it's a very good feeling. I feel like they have some tools in place to address this particular issue. Did you ask about budgetarily an issue too?
Well, and what was the outcome?
So we're in process right now, and we have a plan in place, though, to take a look at performance of the students this spring on assessments that are coming up in a couple of months. Obviously, understanding that we don't expect the full value of this tool to be realized at that time, but then is it appropriate to spread out to our other school to a broader set of students? Is it useful? So they're sort of piloting it. They're kind of piloting it right now, but based on a specific need of the students.
Prior to this, because this is a new.
Sure.
How long ago did you notice this
It had gotten significantly worse in the last test administration, So it had been there to some extent, but it had gotten worse. And there have been some other things tried, but it hasn't been, we didn't go for a very intensive, narrow focus with this group of
people. From the March testing?
From last March, yes. Correct.
Mm-hmm. Parents being involved in their children's lives as they are growing up is vitally important. This does not end as their children enter middle and high school. For instance, parent conferences at this level, especially high school, are not well attended. Even as these young people are gaining more freedoms as they grow older, they still need their parents involved. An involved parent helps keep their children engaged. How do you encourage and require more parental involvement at these ages and stages in school?
The activities at the school surrounding parent events need to be applicable to information that are useful for families at that time. There's been some things attempted to draw parents into schools more that where the agenda of the meeting centers on maybe some college preparation, filling out financial aid forms, dealing with difficult teenagers, for example. So there's a lot of topics, I think, that you can draw into a meeting that draw parents in, and then you might be able to pass along other information you want to as well. At parent-teacher conferences, you can have other things built into them where they have a chance to visit other stations, or college reps are there, or someone from Macomb is there to discuss dual enrollment. So you have a multi-purpose evening so that even if the primary purpose from the school's perspective, is to draw them into conferences or to an open house or some other information. There are other things to tease the parents into the building that are very tangible for their students.
In order to compensate for the overall decline in enrollment in our district, we have opened our doors to school of choice students. Despite our best efforts, our enrollment continues to decline by about 200 students every year. What specific steps have you taken to address this problem in the districts that you have led or based on you have learned about Lansing's district? What recommendations might you make to address this issue that ultimately has a negative impact on our budget?
Ultimately does not have a negative impact?
Has a negative impact.
It has a negative impact.
Yeah, this problem has
It does, yes. Well, again, we're talking about big issues in education right now, obviously. Unfortunately, schools of choice is a zero-sum game. And when I say that, it's that the pool of students available is defined. It is not, it's not like a business where you can try to find more resources or more inputs in the organization. There are only so many students available. So there are winners and losers in that, and it has created a competitive environment that's not healthy. But it is something that if you're not engaged in at this time, at least, you are at a big disadvantage because of our neighborhoods, neighboring schools and whatnot. I don't think it's a long-term solution. I think it is a stopgap measure for dealing with legislation, dealing with political issues that prohibit us from raising funds within our own district to solve these issues. Before we had Proposal A, Lance Cruz, one of the great things about Lance Cruz is when we ask the voters, they've been supportive every time. We have never had issues with those things. And although all we can ask for now is bond money, we used to ask for operational money and the answer was yes. And if we could do that, that would be a big step to helping with this issue and dealing with declining enrollment. I think also, though, I think perception is reality for school shopping right now. Unfortunately, school shopping is what people do. We do border a number of districts with different needs, demographics, whatnot, and you have to make programs desirable to families and make them something that is attracting families into the district. I think working with realtors is important. Working with realtors on housing situations within the district and what the housing market is and what types of availability there are, and then going out and marketing with realtors so when they are showing homes that parents see what Lance Cruz is all about, might make a difference when making a home purchase or a choice when they're shopping around. I did some research a couple of years ago that showed that primarily one of the reasons Lance Cruz was having issues is because we did not have a lot of new construction in our district. And when we talked to parents who had moved, many of them were not moving far, but moving somewhere north of Hall Road pretty typically. But the amount of space in Chippewa Valley or Utica, for example, is nearly indefinite compared to us. And when you talk to the parents, they had no issue with our schools. They thought they were fine. They moved and then found out where the school was. They moved and then found out where it is they were going to go to school before that was the secondary issue. So how it's important to bring into the minds of parents when making those decisions, remind them constantly and consistently of the program in the district, because quite frankly, we have more programming and options than many of our neighborhood districts do. And the perception and reality do not align. So I think it's making sure people know when they're making decisions on where to live, what we have, and maybe perhaps second guessing where they choose to move to when they go to a new home or something like that based on what they will lose or leave behind. Well, right now, in the current legislative state, I think it's a solution that we are living with. And I think it's a solution we're living with. But it has been, we have generally been a net gainer in school of choice. For most communities, we gain students from them. But that program has decimated some of our neighborhood, our districts nearby. And I think in a time when that's not necessary, I think it requires serious reevaluation. if we have ways of locally creating income sources, or we have a time when stabilization of our student population occurs, then I think it's good to readdress. But it is unfortunately something I feel that we are tied into right now because of the legislative situation we're in. Yes?
With the federal government opinion on school of choice, do you see them, in our states, you can only go within your county. Do you see it being expanded from county to county?
Well, right now we could choose to go cross counties if we want to. Lance Cruz has not chosen to do that, although some districts have. I do think that it's sort of a who will go first with some of these things. And once there's a critical mass of districts making those choices, then you get in a position where you really have to look at yourself and see if that's something you want to do or not. I think with us now, we don't border any other counties, so the pressure for us to do that is not something that's, I think, been entertained by the board or something we've really had to seriously consider. But I do know a lot of the bordering schools that border St. Clair and Wayne have done that because, again, unfortunately, it's a very sad thing, to be honest with you, because it's one winner creates a loser somewhere else. And we've really seen an expansion and contraction of districts based on that law that have been probably bad for kids in the end. Yeah.
Where do you feel that you need the most professional development? What are you willing to do to strengthen yourself in that area?
Well, over the past, being in a large district, you do have exposure to a lot of things at a very sort of complicated and complex level. There's so many different operations here, support operations, direct operations, business. The business department is a business in itself. We are running ourselves with a very large budget, $110 million budget, over 1,000 employees, 11,000 students. So it's complex. And I think I have been involved in a lot of those processes recently. When the deputy superintendent position was eliminated, and I've sort of reflected on this now, I've taken on a lot of those roles. So I've had a lot of work in budgetary process of the large budget, of looking at reductions, of HR. I've been heavily involved in negotiations. I've been heavily involved in labor work with issues with unions and grievances that they might have. So I've really worked in a lot of different departments out of curriculum recently. That's not where my heart is originally, but I've had some experience in those areas. But I guess my biggest growth area would be expanding the advocacy of working with the ISD, of working with leaders at the ISD to make more connections with people, to find more about who the players are at the state level and start forming those relationships. So it's really, my growth area needs to be beyond Lance Cruz, beyond Lance Cruz. I feel like I have a good understanding of a lot of the processes, rather complicated processes of our various departments in the district. It's really becoming effective at the advocacy piece of the position.
What motivates you to succeed as a superintendent?
The success of students and staff. The success of students and staff. I mean, that's a very general answer, but I think that if staff and students are successful, everyone is successful. Everyone is here. The superintendent's a support position. School board's a support position. Everyone's a support in some sort of support position to teaching and learning of kids. And I think as we all have to realize and equalize our roles and understand we're here for kids, we're here for student learning, and everyone has a super important role in that. They should have and can have a passionate interest in advancing student learning. I think seeing kids going to graduation and remembering students that I talked to, maybe in the office a couple of times, seeing kids who were struggling in the past, seeing kids that have overwhelmed or gone through some tremendous challenges in their life and becoming successful, coming back to us afterwards, that is success. That feels like success. It is success. And I think we want to have every student have that type of a story, every student have a success path, a upward trajectory. And that's what success is, I think.
Mr. Ross,
Mr. Rudolph, you spoke in your presentation a little bit about the strategic planning process.
Yes.
I'd like you to kind of take it a little bit further.
Sure.
And talk about what your expectations are for that plan. For example, measurable goals, both quantitative and qualitative, curricular changes, facility changes, etc. How often would you expect to review and report on that plan, and to whom would you report the outcomes?
So strategic planning is important. It is important to have very guidance at the district level. Again, I think it does need to be reviewed. I think it does need to be looked at. As time goes on, the document becomes more irrelevant if you're not checking into the progress of the goals, or if goals become non-meaningful, or a year ago they were something important and now they're not. So looking at it constantly is important. I think looking at that process again is something I'd be interested in doing, perhaps re-engaging in that process, doing some things differently. It is important to engage the community in that process and bring a large group of stakeholders in, but I think they need to understand how important their role is and refine their role and refine their responsibilities in there, so it's not totally open-ended, so the process isn't completely open-ended to those in the room who are volunteering their time. So I think focusing the efforts of the district, and I think so some work needs to be done first to look at the current goals in the strategic plan and put them through a couple of lenses. One is, are they measurable? I think without them being measurable, and we can agree on what the measurability of them is, they're not good goals. They're probably not very effective goals. So again, is it measurable, and can we all agree, school board, superintendent, school district, that we know what the outcome of that goal looks like? Do we understand what the successful outcome of that goal is? So I think it's looking at the current ones, and then when the work begins, really giving people some specific duties that they have, making them accountable for some specific part of the plan, educating them on what measurable goals are, what a short-term goal versus a long-term goal, giving some parameters to the process. I think it was a little too open-ended. I think the goals are sometimes too general in the plan. So again, you can't measure if it was a successful plan or not unless you can agree and measure the outcome. So that would be through those views that we would re-engage in that process of strategic planning.
How would you keep apprised of these goals? I mean, is it the board, is it the staff, is it the community?
It's everyone. It's everyone. I think it's everyone. I think certainly the board would be very interested in how the process was going. The board would likely be involved in the process. Board members would be involved in the process. But I think, again, reporting out to the full board at established timelines of how it's going, or just even casually talking about how it's going when a question is asked, that's fine too. But it's also the staff too. They need to understand how their role is very important in the process. That if you don't see why you're in the strategic planning room, if you don't understand why you're there and you just volunteered because you like to help the school, that's not enough. I think we really have to inform the process of the people in the room, so then they are out informing others and talking about the process as well. So there's word of mouth on this, and there's also verbal written communications as well.